Hello, and welcome to our quarterly economic update video, where we give a quick rundown of last quarter's market activity and take a look at what may lie ahead. This quarter, we're focusing on a shot in the arm, the rollout to recovery. HUB investment team members Justin Fisk, Chris Karam, and Jay Sanford will take us through the numbers. Justin, I'll hand it over to you.
Thanks, Sarah. Our last quarterly update painted the picture of economic recovery in the second half of 2020. This time around, we'll share first quarter performance and show changes in sector leadership since November 6th, which was the last business day before the announcement of a successful vaccine. In addition, we'll cover the improvement in the unemployment picture and the interplay between fiscal policy, monetary policy, interest rates, and inflation. With that, let's move to the anatomy of a recession dashboard from ClearBridge Investments. First, notice that the most recent overall signal at the bottom of the page is green, indicating continued expansion since mid-2020. Looking at the indicator categories, we see all green in financial with stable credit spreads, continued easy monetary policy, and an upward sloping yield curve. In business activity, truck shipments are stable, but this proxy for economic activity has room to grow. In consumer, housing permits and retail sales are green, but we see yellow in jobless claims and red in job sentiment and wage growth. Keep in mind that consumer spending drives around 70% of US GDP and that wage and raw material price increases could be passed along in the form of inflation, which Chris will discuss later. The next slide shows global vaccinations with each line reflecting the percent of a country's population having received at least one vaccine dose. We in the US have started to feel the positive effects of vaccination efforts, but only the UK outshines the US on this chart. And other countries in South America, Europe, and Asia are considerably lower. Food for thought for global investors. Next, we see US progress to herd immunity driven by vaccinations and those who have recovered from the virus. Note here that herd immunity is shown as an estimated range, not an event that happens all at once. Also, at the time of this recording, the CDC and FDA had recommended pausing use of the Johnson & Johnson vaccine to investigate rare but severe cases of blood clots in 6 women who have been vaccinated. Moving to US unemployment, since the peak of 14.8% last April, unemployment has decreased to 6%, and the March 1-month net change in jobs shows leisure and hospitality recovering 280,000 jobs. With that, I'll pass it to Jay for a closer look at asset class returns.
Thanks, Justin. We'll start our look at Q1 with the familiar pincushion. Small caps continue to dominate the chart as they did in 2020, which is not too big of a surprise given the 2020 recession isn't too far off in the rearview mirror. What does create an interesting conversation though is the presence of REITs and commodities in the top three. Real estate has finally found its footing while the reopen trade has pushed commodities up the charts. Conversely, bond yields have risen sharply in 2021, pushing fixed income to the bottom of the chart. Faithfully, a properly allocated portfolio denoted by the asset allocation square puts an investor safely in the middle of the pack. There's plenty of granular bits of information within the next few slides. The rotation to value, which started in Q4 of 2020, continues in Q1 of 2021, based on the chart in the upper right corner, with large, mid, and small value equities leading the charge. Surprisingly, there is a solid balance between growth and value since the market lows of March 2020, which can be seen on the lower right chart. Many, including myself, before seeing this chart, thought that growth had outpaced value since that decline. That just isn't the case, and it will be interesting to see how the rest of the year plays out. This next slide is my favorite for this update, showing the vast differences in return streams of the various sectors. These are the returns before and after the vaccination announcement in November. Not surprising, but visually stark, we can see the reopen trade in full bloom since November of 2020, with energy, transportation, REITs, and leisure leading the charge. I think the next big question is, where do we go from here? With that question in mind, here's a look at the PE ratio or valuation of the stocks that make up the S&P 500. Is there anywhere to go? Are valuations already too high across the board? The graph on the right shows how influential the top 10 holdings are within the S&P 500, making up 27% of the index, and that was even higher at the start of 2021. The graph on the left shows how rich those top 10 holdings are today, both historically and compared to the other 490 stocks within the S&P 500. Granted, this quarter, we did see a decline in those top 10 holdings, providing a brief respite for some value-minded investors. In the end, it is the E in PE ratio that must grow in order to sustain the current levels. As earnings season begins, we will soon see where the earnings land within the next couple of weeks. Now I'll pass it to Chris to discuss international markets and fixed income. Chris?
Yeah, thanks, Jay. And you talked a little bit about the rotation of the markets from growth to value. You talked about the focus on fundamentals, which the market is definitely shifting towards and really emphasizing the earnings of the E and the P to E ratio. And what we're seeing, however, is relative to the US valuations, we are still seeing opportunities overseas. As a matter of fact, overseas equities not only are trading at a significant price to earnings discount to the US, but also offer higher dividend yields. Now, a couple other contributing factors could make international equities very appealing in this environment. First and foremost, due to COVID relief and other measures taken by governments around the world, the US in particular finished their fiscal year September 30th, 2020 budget with a over $3 trillion deficit. Now, that equated to over 15% of GDP, which is a staggering number, a number we haven't seen since World War II. On pace for fiscal year ended September 30th, 2021, with current federal bills working their way through Congress, we could see another $3 trillion plus deficit should a package like the infrastructure bill, which is currently being considered by Congress, make its way all the way through to presidential signature. As a result, the budget deficits are starting to place a little pressure on the US dollar. What they're also doing is generating concerns for inflation, which we'll get to more in a moment. But because of those concerns, we're seeing yields rise in the US Treasury marketplace. So if we look at the three different yield curves that you see here, most recently, March 31st, 2021 in the middle, along with a 10-year range of the yield curve in the gray background, one of the things you'll notice is that we have had yields pick up substantially from August of last year, where the 10-year yield resided at 0.52%, to the end of March, where the 10-year yield rose to 1.74%, and the 30-year yield rose to 2.41%. This is a market increase from where we were just a handful of months ago and reflects the fact that the economy is improving and we have concerns about rising inflation. Those higher yields put pressure on fixed income returns in the first quarter of the year. So let's focus in a little bit more on this inflation story, because this is something we'll be watching more closely throughout the rest of 2021. There are a variety of ways to measure inflation, two of which you see here, both in what producers pay and what consumers pay, in particular, the rate of change. So producers have notably had a big surge in the prices that they pay to manufacture and create the goods and services that we as consumers consume. In fact, most recently, that indicator rose to 2.54% versus what consumer inflation is measured at 1.41%. So there's a big disconnect between what producers are paying to create the goods and services and what consumers are paying for those goods and services. We would expect those two numbers to get closer together and to see a little bit more inflation at the consumer good level. And what will be determined is whether or not this is sustainable. Will we have sustained upward increases in inflation, and how will that impact markets? That story in particular is the one we're going to be watching for the rest of 2021 and well into 2022 as we track this recovery. So in summary, with the rollout of the vaccines, we have seen a movement closer towards herd immunity, which has allowed the economy to reopen, which has added over 960,000 jobs in the month of March alone and pushed our unemployment rate down to 6%. And that's allowed the equity markets globally to move higher, but with some concerns about the budget deficit's impact on rising rates and rising inflation. Thanks for listening. I'm going to turn it back over to Sarah.
Thanks, Chris. To receive notification of upcoming economic update videos, including our second quarter mid-quarter update, you can subscribe using the link below.